Gary with the T, and you're listening, hearing, watching the Michael Finkley Show.
Hey, what's up? I'm Tony Terry, and you're watching the Michael Finkley Show. You gotta listen to Michael Finkley Show. I do. Peace.
My name is Rhonda Saunders. I'm shouting out the Michael Finkley Show, okay?
See, I like her, you know? I like her because of her edges, you know? Because she got that baby hair.
If you are not watching the Michael Finkley Show, you are behind the times. Catch up and watch my brother Michael Finkley wherever he is.
All right.
This is Diamond Jack, and I would want to shout out Michael Finkley. He's amazing, y'all, and I love him so much already, and I just met him.
Yo, this your boy Ernest Miller, aka Excalibur, owner of Train Soul University, also Shop Talk and the Mill Experience. You are now watching the Michael Finkley Show. Check him out.
If I can make it through the night, just to see a brighter side, 'cause I've been working on.
Everybody, welcome to the Michael Finkley Show. Thanks for joining us today. You know, we all go through things in life, and the things that we go through are experiences. And those experiences make us stronger, but it's up to you to learn from them. If you're not willing to learn, you're doomed to actually repeat them. And so again, with our experiences, we improve, we learn, we grow, and we go to that next dimension in life where we need to be and where we see ourselves as successful. And each person defines success differently in their own right. And so today's guest, Mykey Stone, is with us for the very first time in a very exclusive interview, talks about his struggles, his pains, his triumphs, his positivities, and much more. So don't you go away. Back in a moment.
Coming up, Mykey Stone is with us. Don't you go away.
Hey, what's happening, everybody? This is Garfield Bright from the Platinum R&B group Shy. I'm also Dr. Garfield Bright. And look, you're watching Michael Finkley Show on Roku and YouTube. Continue checking it out. It's the greatest thing in the world.
If I ever fall in love again, I will be sure that the lady is a friend.
Y'all, it's a celebration. 150 shows of Finkley, with special guest, actress Arisha Connor, and actor Keith Brown. Come on, join us! Friday!
In these times, Columbia needs a mayor who's a proven leader, who can respond to crisis and be ready to get to work for you on day one. I've done that on City Council. Together, we've celebrated victories, and we've taken on challenges. Together, we've invested in building a better Columbia. And together, we will lift Columbia into greatness. I'm ready to get to work with you and for you as the next mayor, but I need your voice and your vote. I'm Tamika Isaac Devine, and I'm asking for your vote on November 2nd.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Michael Finkley Show. And my next guest, very special guest. And I can't wait for you all to hear his story. It's a story like no other, I promise you. Wait and see. He is big and tall model Mykey Stone. Mykey, thank you for being with us today.
Thank you, Michael. I'm so appreciative to be on your show.
You're very welcome. And when you reached out to me and we had that conversation and all the things that, you know, you were dealing with, have dealt with, I'm like, yeah, this story needs to be told. And so let's go back, right? Let's go back to Virginia. What was life like growing up in Virginia?
So life was like growing up in Virginia. Pretty much I was a son of a single parent. My mother worked four jobs. I don't know how she did it. But, you know, I grew up, you know, I won't say in the ghetto, but, you know, I grew up in the urban area of Richmond, Virginia, a small community called Randolph, close-knit community. And, you know, times were hard. There were many days that, you know, I had to actually remember sitting at my mother's job. She worked at Shoney's, if anybody remembers that, as she worked. So I know the lessons of hard work through my mother. My father, of course, was not around, but I had my strong great-grandmother, my grandmother, and my mother as a support system, and my two uncles. So Richmond, a lot of people from here, you know, we're pretty much a great city to grow up in, really.
All of that. Humble beginnings in your own right, you know, single parent, dealing with those things. I know what that's like. There were three of us. There are three of us, and mom has to raise all of us as well on a fixed income. Definitely know what that's like. But in all of that, you decided that you were going to be different, that you were going to be unique. What were some of your passions and your influences in your life for becoming a model?
Some of my influencers were actually like Tyra Banks and, Tyra Banks, Elle McPherson, and Tyson Beckford. Those three were like the epitome of what I thought was high fashion. Tyson Beckford in particular. I just love Tyson Beckford because he had a strong presence. He had a great sense of style, and he was he broke barriers. He broke molds, being the first one in urban hip hop fashion with FUBU and Ralph Lauren. I really looked up to him when I was younger. So that was a great influence for me. But also, I had great teachers at school, as far as art teachers. They really expounded my love of art. Also modeling, of course, I love that, but I love drawing. I love writing poetry. Love singing, love karaoke. So I do a lot of things creatively, artistically, and the public schools here in Richmond really fostered my creativity to really do all the things that I do today.
Love that. You know, that support team behind us really makes a difference. And living out what we really want to do. Sometimes some people don't have it, right? It takes a little bit longer at times. You have that support behind you. At what point in your life did you say to yourself, this is my talent. This is my purpose. This is my it for me. What was that like?
My talent. So strange story, but I love, again, being creative. So when I was around 14, 15 years old, I used to get like magazines like The Source and Word Up, those type of magazines. And I used to take all the people that influenced me and I used to put them up all around my bedroom, and really creatively interior design is another thing that I love to do. I did interior design in my room. And I was like, you know what? I do have a bug for all this creative, artistic stuff. Right. But also, I was like, you know what? I know that I can take a great photo. I know that I can do a good walk. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to be the first. That's why I said to myself, the first big and tall model ever. But joke's on me. But I was thinking that around 16, 17 years old. And, you know, the influence of Tyson Beckford really stuck with me throughout my years. But, you know, I graduated from high school and I just took a job like everybody else. I did not go to school. Hopefully one day I will. But I did not go to school. I just worked like the rest of us. And I kind of slept. And this is what I tell a lot of my followers. I slept on my dreams a lot. And that's not a good thing to do, because your dreams are your gifts, and your gifts come from what? God. So, you know, it's is just invaluable to use exactly what God gives you, what God instills in you and pours into you, and share it with the world. And that's what I'm doing today.
Love it. And we're so glad you're doing it. You know how many people you're inspiring right now? How many people are saying that I'm sitting on my gifts as well, but because I'm hearing these words, right? Because yes. I'm seeing your actions, I'm going to go for it. I'm going to go for it. The worst thing they can say is no, right? And the greatest thing they can say is yes. So I'm going to go for it. I'm so glad that you're doing it. At what age did you decide to pursue modeling?
So the age that I decided to pursue, it was around my 30th birthday. I did a photo photography meet up with a local photographer when I was living in Charlotte, North Carolina. And I started there, but then again, I drifted back to working, and I've been working in the hospitality industry for probably over 10 years. I said, you know, in 2019, which was 2 years ago in August, that was the date that I said, you know, enough of the 9 to 5. I basically put in my resignation, and I just decided to do me. I took down all of the things that I knew how to do, wrote them down. And I was like, you know, I'm going to cross these off one by one. But the modeling thing happened first. It took off first, and I am the better for it. You know, I basically clawed my way from nothing to something. So I'm just appreciative to God for it.
Amazing. Hard work does pay off.
Yeah.
Definitely does pay off. And look, you know, at a mature age, right, you decided to go after your goals and your dreams, and you classify yourself again as a big and tall model. What type of positive things have you seen? Because we see your pictures, you know, very handsome. We see your pictures, and we see the positivity. What are some of the negative things that we don't really see sometimes behind the scenes that you may have went through to get to where you are right now?
Some of the negative things are, you know, so one of the things that I do when I was a freelance model, was going to photography meetups. A lot of photographers gather together, creatives gather together in one place, and you basically take free photos to help build your portfolio, but you also build the photographers or the creatives' portfolio. And what I've learned just by that was that some, you know, photographers, some creators, they only want to take a photo of a particular subject, subject meaning the person in front of the camera. Sometimes they are kind of negative towards big and tall or plus size. They only want the slim fit models to take pictures for. So I have witnessed some discrimination as far as size is concerned throughout circles in the creative community. However, you know, sometimes you just have to fall back, get a scope of the room, and really find out who is who, where you should go as far as who you should ask for information and, you know, collaboration and things of that nature. I just think that to bypass some of the negative stereotypes that even people in the creative community do have, you just have to know who to go to, when to go to, who to ask, when to ask, and just do you. You know, everybody is not for everybody, so you just have to network, you have to keep your ear to the street, and you have to hustle.
And hustling you are doing. What are some of your personal successes that you have seen thus far that you're like, you have to stand back and say to yourself, I'm proud of this. I'm proud that I achieved this partnership, this shoot. What are some of those moments?
So the last moment was New York Fashion Week. I just came back from that about 3 weeks ago. Mm-hmm. I walked for Zappos.com for Zappos Adaptive. Zappos Adaptive is a brand that Zappos has that they work with different designers and fashion houses and things of that nature, shoe designers, for adaptable clothing. So because I am a model with disabilities, I am on dialysis, but we're still kicking butt, you know. Sometimes my feet swell. So they had some shoes for me that were adaptable. They are more stretched, more big, more deep and in depth with the shoe. They had some adaptable clothes from Ralph Lauren for me. So I walked for Zappos.com for New York Fashion Week. So New York Fashion Week is like the creme de la creme of modeling. It's like the Super Bowl of modeling, like the Grammys for modeling. Mm-hmm. And, you know, for me to be just 2 years into being a model, mm-hmm. is an amazing feat. So that's what I really am happy about specifically. But also I've worked with Tyra Banks. So Tyra Banks. Yeah. So she had a challenge. So during the pandemic, a lot of people were kind of being sappy during the pandemic, and she made a page on Instagram called Modeland, and she did different challenges for models to do and for us to submit to, and I submitted for the Body Oddy Challenge for people of plus size, big and tall men, and I sent it, and the creators of Modeland, they put me on the first of the carousel of models on Modeland. So that's another major feat. Never thought that I would be talking to Tyra Banks, much less being on any of her social medias. So,
wow.
Yeah.
That's all I can say. Wow. And you said, you know, just 2 years in, but it doesn't matter the time frame. It also just depends on your passion, your determination, yeah. in your craft as well. I'm a strong believer that our gifts will make room for us because gifts are natural. You mentioned earlier about your health, right? You mentioned your health. When we come back, we're going to talk more in depthly about those different health scares that you had in the past that many people still don't know about to this day. Back in a moment.
Next, Mykey opens up about his health scares. Back in a moment.
Hey, what's up? It's Nick Gallagher, the guy you know. You're watching The Michael Finkley Show.
Keeping your skin flawless and clean is important. And I have the products just for you.
Welcome to Mimi's Natural Pantry,
where she specializes in homemade handcrafts, including
rye and goat milk soaps,
body butters,
and sugar scrubs. All items are handmade products. All items have simple ingredients and are vegan friendly.
In a world where you can barely pronounce many of the ingredients in your everyday products, Mimi's Back to Nature offers an alternative choice for those who are ready to get back into nature. Ready to order? Visit their website at mimisnaturalpantry.com. All orders over $50 have free shipping up to 25 pounds.
Welcome back to the Michael Finkley Show. We're still chatting with Mykey Stone, and he talks about his amazing, amazing journey within the modeling industry. But there were some setbacks sometimes with him. A lot of health scares. Can you tell us about those? The first time you realized something's wrong?
So the first time I realized something was wrong was probably back in 2008. Mm-hmm. My left arm was like hurting so bad. And come to find out, when I went to the ER, my blood pressure was through the roof. That was the first time when I had a real scare with blood pressure. So took the pills, did what I was supposed to do initially, but, and you know, I'm just being real with everybody. I just did not take care of the take care when it was time to take care. Right. And that's what I'm trying to, you know, push home to everybody. Take care of the take care when you need to take care of it, because it can be lethal. So over the years, you know, I just kind of dipped and dodged, taking my pills, not taking my pills, making excuses, things of that nature, and not paying attention to my body, not paying attention to my body, mind, and soul, really. And, you know, that comes from, you know, sometimes I got depressed. Sometimes I just was not with it. Sometimes I was just stressed. And, you know, the cares of the world, it was just, sometimes it was just a lot on me as a young Black man, just doing my thing. But, you know, I'm better for it now. So I'm an advocate for heart disease. I'm an advocate for kidney disease, because those are the two things that I currently have. So as time went on, right, eventually it caught up with me.
Before you get to that other part of the of your story, you said before, you, as you were explaining yourself, you said that you knew, but you still didn't take care of yourself. Why?
I believe because I was not putting myself first in everything. I don't think that I was my own best friend. You know, sometimes we need friends to pump us up, push us, and give us a hug, give us a kiss. But sometimes we have to affirm within ourselves that we are enough, that we do deserve better, and that whatever ails you, you know, God can fix it. You have to sought the Lord. You have to pray. You have to seek his face. You have to read scripture, all that good stuff. And those are stuff that I just was not doing, to be real, for real. And now, you know, after all of this, you know, I am definitely loving myself, loving on myself, loving with myself, loving around myself, because I know that I'm here for a purpose. So yeah.
Gotcha. That was not it. There was more, right?
So what happened was everything caught up with me back in 2021, January. So January 3rd was a Sunday, and I was in my living room cleaning up, and all of a sudden I had this big, it just felt like a burst. It felt like my cheeks was just going like ba-boom. And it went from my cheek to my chest all the way down my leg. And it was this crazy, crazy pain. And I was like, okay, need to call the ambulance. So did that. Long story short, I had a aortic dissection. An aortic dissection, a lot of people have not heard of it. It's a form of a heart attack. So if you feel on your chest, every time your heart is beating, that's your aorta pumping that blood to that heartbeat, right? So your aorta is the pump that pumps the blood. And what happened was there was a tearing of my aorta walls inside of my aorta, and it went through my aorta about to rupture the aorta. Yeah. So, and I'm sorry.
What caused that?
What caused that was the high blood pressure and the uncontrolled high blood pressure for the many years that I had it since around 2008, 2009.
Gotcha.
And what happened was the blood went through my aortic walls, and then it cut off blood flow to my other organs, which is my kidney. They saved everything else, but my kidney was affected. So that's why I'm on dialysis. But I just want to bring home to everybody that this aortic dissection, which is like a form of a heart attack, like 25% of people usually die under 6 hours of the people that get the aortic dissection. 50% die when it's at 24 hours. And then when it goes to a week, usually 2/3 of people do not make it. So there's not many people that get an aortic dissection, but the few that do don't, you know, survive. So it's imperative that we watch our blood pressure, that we eat right. I mean, I'm daggone near a vegan at this point, because it's crucial. So aortic dissection is no joke. Basically, it's very lethal. And, you know, I'm just glad to be here today. You know, I have a second chance at life. So I want to tell the viewers that this is life. Like, seriously, you have to take your life seriously. And I just thank God that he gave me enough grace to get through it. You know, every day is not the greatest day, but every day is the day that the Lord has made. So, you know, I just rejoice every day because I know that I don't have to be here. Right. Exactly. So I'm just appreciative to be here.
Well, we're so glad you are here. Yeah. So glad you are here. You are one of those percentages that are still here and you're telling a story. How are you living out your second chance?
So I'm living out my second chance, of course. You know, I just say I'm trying to go vegan, but we'll see how that works. But I'm watching what I eat. I'm watching portion control. Being on dialysis, there are certain foods that I can't eat anyway. But I'm doing more exercise, more portion control with the food, watching what I eat, and just being more active in general. So with modeling, of course, that's active within itself. But I go to the gym maybe 2 or 3 times a week. I do a lot of walking, probably like 15 to 20 minutes, whatever I can absorb, because sometimes my chest still hurts from the surgery. They did everything that they could, but, you know, sometimes, you know, they have to pay attention to, I have to get an MRI and all CAT scans and things of that nature just to make sure that the stent that they put in my heart is still intact and things of that nature. So, you know, sometimes I'm like drained because of dialysis and the aorta. But, you know, other days I have a lot of energy and I try to use it properly to, you know, push home my career. It was on hiatus for about 6 months and I've slowly gotten back into doing modeling again, of course, with New York Fashion Week. But a lot of the things that I was doing, we were at home anyway. So I did a lot of stuff at home during the pandemic. I am now a partner with iZod. iZod is a clothing brand, of course, that caters to big and tall men. And I think I was about 16, 17 years old when I started wearing iZod. I don't know anybody know about Dillard's or Belk, but I used to go back there with my grandma and shop. And iZod was number one because everything else was tight. So I'm so grateful to iZod for that. And, you know, I'm just trying to do whatever I can to push the narrative that big and tall men can do anything. We can do the same things that the fit models do. So, you know, all of my pictures, I try to like carefully select the concept because I don't want people to be thinking that, you know, a big and tall man, all we do is wear suits and a hat and that's it. Like, I'm a creative. I dream in color. So everything that I do, I try to dream in color and I try to put it on the screen.
So, and that you do. He does a darn good job with it, I tell you. Please go out and check out his book. He is amazing. So many people, after hearing your story, right, or even persons that may experience something similar to what you've been through, some of them just stop, right? They just stop where they are. They stay in this suppressive mode, and some keep going, right? Some just keep going as you do. Why did you decide to continue to live? Why did you decide to keep going?
I decided to live because I like myself. I love myself. I want more of me. And I want to help others become more of themselves. I don't want to be just a stick figure, just a vain model that, you know, thinks that I'm cute and sexy and all of this without trying to promote body positivity. Body positivity is the number one goal that I'm trying to reach. I'm trying to help other big and tall men that have self-esteem issues, that have where they don't think that they're enough. I'm trying to push the envelope. So whenever I'm doing my pictures, whenever I'm doing content, creating content, I think about guys like when I was, you know, growing up and not thinking that, you know, me, myself, and I was enough. Just because I'm big. I mean, hey, ain't nothing wrong with a little fat, but we all we all are here for a purpose. And I think when guys don't think that they are enough, they don't, you know, get into their purpose. So I just want people to know that, you know, when I'm out here modeling, I'm representing you. I'm representing the people that don't think that they are enough, right? So.
Love it. And what an awesome message that people need to hear, especially in this day and time, especially after what our world has been through, right? So thank you for that. How can they find you on social media?
Well, they can find me on Facebook, Mykey, M-Y-K-E-Y Stone, or on Instagram, M-Y-K-E-Y _ Stone on Instagram. I had a little issues with my page, but I'm on TikTok at Only Mykey and YouTube Only Mykey.
All right, you heard it here, and all your information is in the description below. Mykey Stone, thank you so much for being
all right. I appreciate it. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Back in a moment.
This is St. James, singer, songwriter, producer, R&B baby, and I'm chilling with my man, Michael Finkley, and you're watching The Michael Finkley Show. You can check it out live on YouTube, the RokuTV, via the Greater Works Network. Hey, I appreciate the opportunity to kick it with my man, Michael. Make sure you tune into his show. I'm telling you, you will not be disappointed. Let's get it, baby.
Can't you see that I just wanna be enough?
School districts, organizations, nonprofits, are you in search of a new promotional products company?
Seeger's Promotional Products is a Black-owned national company with over 780,000 products to choose from. Compared to other promotional products companies, they have the lowest prices in the industry. From pens, bags, shirts, they got you covered. They always remember that you are the customer and you come first. They always promise fast production and also fast delivery. With Seeger's Promotional Products Company, you truly have the best. Check out their website at seegerspromotions.com and also on Facebook and LinkedIn.
And tell them Finkley sent you.
What's up, guys, man? It's the Michael Finkley Show. I'm ready to come and give y'all a word. So something that I've been learning, something that I learned over a year, is when you don't love yourself anymore, when you stop doing the things that you got to get over trauma, that you got to heal yourself, that you got to better yourself. The moment that you stop doing those things is the moment that those traumas and bad habits unfold. The moment that the wounds that you had come back. The moment that them negative thoughts come back. You have to keep doing the work. And oftentimes, you know what people think, and I feel like social media kind of plays a role in this, is that we feel like, oh, I'm going to just work out for this amount of time and I'm going to forever have abs. I'm going to go meditate for a certain amount of time and I'm going to forever think these thoughts. No. No. Once you get to doing that, you have to make it a daily routine for the rest of your life. Because healing don't have a time on it. Healing don't have a permanent spot. Healing takes forever. It's a forever journey. So once you get on this journey and you fall off, all the great things that was happening with you, all the results that you made along this journey, then disappears. It's called muscle memory. You get into a routine or something and you stop doing it, you lose that muscle memory. So now you have to do it again to get that muscle memory back. But if you stop doing it, everything that you done gained, everything that you done worked hard for, you losing it and you back at square one. Don't get back to square one. Let's stay ahead. So keep doing what you're doing. Keep healing. Keep growing. Keep meditating. Keep working out. Keep eating healthy. You know what I'm saying? Keep pushing yourself in whatever that may be. And you might not do any one of them things. You might do different things. But in whatever you do to better yourself, keep doing that. Do not stop. We don't want to go back to square one. We want to keep moving forward.
It's the White Host Jr. with Dan Chappelle's Up, and you're watching The Michael Finkley Show on Roku TV and YouTube, baby.
Y'all, it's a celebration.
150 shows of Finkley, with special guests, actress Arisha Connor and actor Keith Brown.
Come on, join us.
Friday.
Welcome back to the Michael Finkley Show. I hope that you learned something today from our guest, Mykey. Thank you so much for being so open and honest with us in your words, and much success to you as a model in the future. You got it. You got it. Keep going. You got it. If you haven't already, please subscribe to our YouTube channel, The Michael Finkley Show. Ring the bell for notification. We'll send you an email saying, hey, new content is uploaded. Please listen to us on Spotify and Apple Podcasts. And more information about what we do here on the show, visit our website, michaelfinkleyshow.com. Roku TV, of course, add the Great Words Network to your Roku TV and watch The Michael Finkley Show every Monday and Friday, 8 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, or on demand. Thank you so much for watching, and guess what? We'll see you next time. Have a good one.